All right, good evening, everyone. Very dedicated crowd here. Lots of fans of Go. Jason Veers is a former professional baseball player who pitched in the major leagues from 1972 to 1983. In 77, Veers won a career-high 20 games for the Twins and was tied for the most wins in the American League with Dennis Leonard and Jim Palmer. He appeared in the 81 World Series as a member of the Dodgers. He's here tonight to talk to you, of course, about Go. Jason Veers.
All right, thank you, Jim. A little footnote to that introduction is that in 1981, I left the Dodgers because that is when I was born. And so then that kind of put a little stint in my baseball career. So my name is Jason Veers. I'll be talking about Go. First, a little warning. I have no idea what I'm talking about. I'm not a great Go player. I'm not even a good Go player. I'm a horrible Go player. But I really like the game. I think it's lots of fun, and I'm familiar with the rules, so I really want to share it with people. And that's the end of the presentation. So are there any questions? Yes, thank you. So that's the end of the PowerPoint presentation. I'm going to go to a Go board to discuss it. The software I'm going to be using here is called JGo. It's a Java Go program. It's open source, so it can run on just about any platform. It freezes my Linux machine for some reason, but it is available if you want to try it. So Go is a board, is a game played on a 19 by 19 board. And this game is played on the intersections rather than the squares. Usually you place your pieces in the squares, and Go, they're placed on the intersections themselves. So when I say 19 by 19, it's counting the number of intersections, and here you can see the intersections themselves are labeled. It's two players play between black and white, take turns placing stones on the board. Once a stone is placed, it is never moved around. There's no shuffling of stones, you just add more stones to the board. Again, unless the stones are captured, which is something I'll get to a little bit later. You're trying to surround as much territory as possible and capture as many prisoners as possible. One of the main mechanics of the game is liberties, which is the number of free spaces around a stone. If a stone has no liberties, then it dies and it's captured. In each of these examples here, each of these stones has four liberties in each of the four directions. Like if I were to start surrounding this white stone with black stones, I'm taking away its liberties as each player adds these stones. So now this white stone only has one liberty left. The space right up here. This stone is said to be an Atari because it's one move away from being captured, kind of similar to a check in chess, except it's not game ending. And so now if white doesn't do anything and black places his stone there, that stone is now captured. White has captured black has captured one of white's stones. Alternatively, white could have played here. When stones are adjacent to each other, they share liberties. So now these stones are permanently linked together and they have a total of three liberties, these three spaces around. Now, if black wants to capture them, he has to capture all of the liberties of all of the stones, then he captures all of the stones. Once you link stones together, there's no splitting up the group, and if you capture one of them, you capture all of them. They're forever joined, you know, till death do they part, in sickness and in health, etc., etc. On this board, you may have noticed there are some darker points in these corners and on the lines, essentially in major divisions. These are called star points. There's nothing in the rules that says they're special. They just happen to be important to the strategy of the game. Similar how in chess, the center of the board ends up being important, more important than the lanes down the sides. The rules don't say the center is important, it just happens to be because that's the way the pieces work. It's similar to this, there's no rules that say these points are special, but they turn out to be a very good balance between offense and defense that we'll talk about later. So capturing is very integral to Go, so I want to practice that a little bit. So we have some scenarios here. Like let's say in the upper left, you know, where can white play to capture a stone? It's pretty obvious. Black has one liberty. I actually need to make it white's turn. That is how black could escape, but now black has one liberty. Now the liberty is gone. In this scenario, where can white play to capture a stone? Anyone? K12. The black, even though both of these stones are touching the same liberty, it still is only one liberty that that black group has. It doesn't matter how many stones are touching it. The fact is, white only needs to make one move in order to capture all of those stones. Okay, what about in the lower left here? Where can white play to capture stones? Yep, it is E2. In this scenario, this black stone has three liberties, this black stone has two liberties, this has one. Black would be able to extend it by going here, but white can cut him off. What about this group down here? There's a lot of mixing going on. This group of three looks like it's in trouble, and it is. It could be captured pretty easily if white were to go here and stop it from linking from that stone, but it has two liberties, one on the left and one on the right, so it cannot be captured right now. However, this black stone on the bottom only has one liberty. So if white goes there, that stone is now captured. Some more details about capturing. It is not possible to suicide. Black is legally not allowed to make this play right here, because if he plays there, the stone would have no liberties, it would immediately be captured. That's it. Similarly, down here, right now this black stone is okay, it has one liberty, but black is not allowed to play in A2 because that would remove the last liberty from that newly formed group, it would immediately be captured. You can't do that. But it is okay to make a play that would result in a capture. In this case, at face value, it might look like black cannot play here, because he's surrounded by white stones, there's no liberties. But if he does play there, then this white group will lose its liberties, and that white group will be captured. Once that group is gone, then the black stone will have liberties. So black is allowed to play there, because once the capturing is resolved, that black stone will have liberties. So as you're going around and capturing each other, you're a little more suicide practice. That's a very strange phrase to use, but yeah. So is black allowed to play in C9? Yes, he is. It's not a smart move, but he is allowed to. He has one liberty left there. He's pretty close to being surrounded, and white will easily be able to capture him, but he is allowed to play there. Is black allowed to play in J9 in this corner? No, he's not, because this white group has two liberties, one here and one here. Black plays here, this group is not captured because it still has a free liberty. Is black allowed to play in C3? In this case, yes, he is. These stones will still have plenty of liberties left around the upper side, but this group has only one liberty, that stone. So if black plays there, he captures it and it's gone. Is black allowed to play in H1? In this case, no, black cannot play because there are no stones that would be captured. Each of these have two liberties, and so they will remain alive after black plays. If the scenario was like this, then black would be able to play in H1 because those stones would be captured, he would have liberties. Any questions on capturing so far? It's very important to the very base of the game, and everything is based off of that. Okay, so as we're playing and capturing, you'll eventually get to the point where there's nothing you want to do. Like in this small board, they've each kind of walled each other off. Black won't want to play in here because it'll be easy to be captured. And white won't want to play in here because it'll be easy for him to be captured. There's pretty much nothing left to resolve. They've each got their own side of the board. This is where the territory comes in for score. When you determine that the game is over, which is something I'll get to later, you get 1 point for each piece of territory you surround. So in this game, white has 5 for this column and 1 here, so a total of 6. Black has 5 plus 2. So black wins this 7-6. Black is surrounding more territory than white. I want to stress that it's very important that your stones do not count for your score. Your territory counts. The stones are simply a means to an end. If this game looked like this, black now has 5 pieces of territory. White wins 6-5. You do not want to fill in your own territory any more than you have to. You simply want to make sure your stones don't get captured. If you put too many stones in your own territory, you're eating away from your own score. So let's look at a slightly more complex example of territory. In this scenario, it's pretty much done. Neither side will want to make any more moves. So what territory is there? Well, black has 4 points up here, these 3 plus 1, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. 9 points of territory. White has 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. I thought they were uneven. Did I count wrong? 2, 4, 6, 7, 8. No? 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. It is 9-9. So there are ways that this would get broken that I'm going to get to later, but so they each have an equal amount of territory. Now there can be situations like, let's say I get rid of this stone and I add in this one. So this territory here, it doesn't really seem to be either black's or white's. It borders each of them, neither of them surrounding it. And that's said to be neutral territory or dame. It doesn't count towards either person's score. Usually once people are done gathering their own territory and they can't claim any more territory, they take turns filling in dame. Because in this situation, it doesn't matter whether black fills it in or whether whether white fills it in. It'll still end up the same score because they're butting up against each other. But what if there's a scenario like this? So is this thing down here neutral territory? And it turns out it's not, because that white stone is very, very doomed. There is no way it can avoid being captured, because black could truly just play down there. The point that made this neutral territory is both of these groups were very large and would be hard, in most cases impossible to capture, so they were each alive on their own. So this white stone is said to be dead. When you're at the end of the game and you find dead stones, they're simply taken as prisoners and they count towards a score. So here, black would get 1 point for the white prisoner and 2 points for the territory. So black would win by 1 point if that were a stone there. Now, something that was very hard for me to understand when I first started playing this is what the difference is between territory and dead stones. Like in this situation, is this black territory, or are these black dead stones inside of white's territory because white's boarding that too? Or are these white stones dead because of black stones here? You know, what is it that makes territory? What is it that makes dead stones? And there is a way for stones to essentially become invincible, and that gets into eyes. And it's what you really want to shoot for as you're playing. Now, starting from basic scenario, in this situation, white's pretty much hosed. There's nothing he can do to avoid being captured by black here. He can try surrounding black around the outside to get all of his stones, but black will be able to fill him in much faster, take his last liberty, and take his stones. Sucks for white. So for a larger example, let's consider this. Now, black looks a little better off. He's surrounding a bit of territory that black can't get to. Black cannot place him there unless that move captures the stones. It's a true statement, but it doesn't stop black from capturing him. Once again, white can try to surround his black stones, but black will win this race by far. First, he has to fill in the above territory, then he can capture those stones. So white was still captured just like he was before. But when we get to this situation, white is surrounding two different points of territory. Now, black cannot play in e5 right now, because the white group, where all these stones are linked together, would have one liberty left, this liberty right here. So it is not legal for black to play in e5. It is not legal for black to play in e2, because if he did, white would have one liberty left in e5. It's a chicken and an egg problem. Black will never be able to capture these stones, because black will never be able to fill in all the liberties at once, because he needs both of those filled in at the same time, and you can't do that. This white group is said to be alive. It is never able to be captured, and the key to this is having two eyes, where the eye is a group of territory surrounded that your opponent is not touching. If a group of stones has two eyes, then it is not possible to capture it, and all the territory it surrounds is definitely in that person's column, and you'll never be able to take it back, you'll never be able to remove those stones. This took a lot of stones to capture 2 points of territory. There was 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13 stones. But it turns out if you don't do it in the center, you can use a lot fewer stones for it. In these situations on the left, both of these white groups are alive. And in the upper left, it's only taking 6 stones, but this group here is touching 2 different points of territory, 2 separate eyes. And this stone is touching 2 different eyes. So these stones will never be able to be captured because black can't fill in both at the same time. In this situation, they are 2 different groups, but they are both touching both eyes, so it works out. Both of them have the invincibility aspect of touching 2 separate eyes at the same time. Here we have 1 group of stones, but it has 2 separate eyes, and again, is invincible. It's along the side, so it takes 6 stones again, as opposed to the 13 we saw in the middle. This is something I'll touch on a little more later. In this situation on the right, white's surrounding 4 points of territory, and we consider that group to be alive. Even though there's 1 eye there right now, but the reason that we consider that is because it's not possible for black to stop him from making an eye. If black wants to capture these stones, he can try moving here, but then white just goes there. And now he has 2 eyes above and below. Similarly, if black does the opposite and goes here, well, then white can go there and make 2 eyes. No matter what black does, he cannot stop white from making 2 eyes. Furthermore, it makes absolutely no difference in score. In this situation, white has 4 points of territory. He'll get 4 points. If black tries to invade, then this is now a dead stone because it's contained within the eyes, and white will have 3 points of territory plus 1 dead stone. 4 points. Same as it was before. It's not even worth doing. So when you get a scenario like this, that group is said to be alive. This happens a bit with advanced players. There'll be a certain shape with amount of space inside of it, and they'll say, okay, that group's alive, just because they've played through the match in their minds, and they know that there's no way they'll be able to capture that group of stones. Any questions so far on being alive and what all entails and how it works? Okay, so we'll work through some examples for that, because that's another one of the very key. Actually, first I'm going to talk about, so when we talk about surrounding territory, you could look at it like this and say, this black group is surrounding all the territory in the upper right. So he gets all that territory and he wins all the points. Yay for him. But it doesn't really work that way, because the only way that that territory is defined as yours is if you can stop your opponent from invading it. There's enough room in here that white is able to place some stones and invade. And this in here actually makes enough space that white will be able to make eyes. In this case, white has cut into black's territory by making his own little hidey hole because black left way too much room in his territory. You really can't mark off wide swaths of territory, not that large, because it leaves too much room for your opponent to invade. So you have to strike a very important balance between establishing enough territory that you get enough score, but if you establish too much, then your opponent will invade and take away your territory. It's very much a balancing act between the two parts. Now, the tricky part comes in. In this situation, we look at this and we say, okay, black has two eyes. Black has an eye here and an eye here, so this can't be captured. But that's actually not true in this situation. The eye at F5 is called a false eye. Anyone have an idea why? The reason is that separate group in the lower right, it can be captured. It's not apparent at first, but if you look very closely, this group is only touching one of the eyes. This group does not touch this eye. It does not possess the property of being invincible of touching two eyes. So in this situation, white can play here, black can do whatever he wants, it doesn't matter. White can capture that group. Now this group is also doing it because it has one eye. These two separate groups never had two eyes together. This group did touch two eyes, but the group that was touching that eye did not touch two eyes, so it was not invincible. This is a situation we call a false eye, and it's something you have to watch very careful for, and is one of the main tripping points in figuring out how to make the stones invincible as you're playing. So let's go through some examples of that. Like in this upper situation, is black alive? In other words, is it possible for white to capture him? If it is there anything black can do to make himself alive, therefore unable to be captured? What was that? D9. And that is correct. These stones are now unable to be captured. This group touches both of these eyes. And this group touches both of these eyes, E9 and D8. The fact that this is open is irrelevant. It doesn't matter. White can take that. It doesn't matter. These stones are still now invincible. In this scenario, it's very tempting, especially for beginners, to want to link up these groups and say, okay, I'll make one supergroup, and now they're more resistant to being captured. But now, by making that move, you actually doom yourself, because now there's no way to make two eyes with that shape, so it's just a matter of time before white surrounds you. Or actually, what will happen is white will just leave in the scenario and will say those are all dead stones, and those will all be white's prisoners. So what's the situation in the lower left? Is it possible for black to be captured right now? If it is there anything he can do but to come alive? Or if it's white's turn, is there anything he can do to prevent his opponent from becoming alive? Is there any, which is called killing the stones, even if it doesn't immediately capture them? You can pretty much agree there's only going to be three possibilities, one of these three. So if black moves down here, now this group is touching two different spaces. This group is touching two different spaces. That looks good, except this isn't an eye because white's bordering it. So now white can move here, and now it doesn't matter what black does, they're doomed. Get rid of that. So what about, well, I need to go back a little more, I believe. I'll let me load this again. So what if black played in here? Need to be black's turn. Yes, black plays in there. The situation is touching two different points of territory, but again, the upper one is not an eye. White can play there. Black's doomed. Open it again. So the territory in the upper left. Now there's two different groups. The upper group is touching both C2 and A1. White's not touching either of them, so those are two eyes. And the lower stone is touching both B2 and A1. There's our two eyes. So this black group is now alive. Does this make sense? Because this is, again, a very important building block to the Go arsenal. This is another one of the things where it's not explicitly defined in the rules, you make eyes. It's just a repercussion of how the rules work. That's a lot of what happens with Go. The rules themselves are very simple. We've pretty much covered all the rules already. We're now starting to get into the strategy that's built off of those rules. That's what makes the game so complex, is what comes from it. One more situation I want to talk about is called Seki, or shared life. This is a unique situation. It doesn't happen very often, but it does happen. For these two groups, the three white stones and the four black stones, it's not possible for white to capture the black stones, because if white were to play and try to take away one of black's liberties, then black would capture him. Fair enough. And it's also not possible for black to capture those white stones, because if black were to play to take away one of his liberties, white would capture him. This arises from the fact that those two groups of stones share the same liberties, so if either opponent takes the steps to kill their opponent, it'll give the other one a jump to kill their own group. These groups are not technically alive because they don't have two eyes, yet they still are not counted as prisoners, they're not removed from the board, because they're not really dead. They just have what's called shared life. They exist themselves, and the two points around here are the shared territory, or dame. Let me see, I think there were some more things. Okay, so finishing a game, what will happen in Go is eventually get to the point where you don't want to do anything else. You'll have opponent's territory, you don't want to play in there because he'll just make a prisoner and you don't want to give him any of your dead stones. And you don't want to play in your own territory because it's already secured and you don't want to place it unnecessarily because that takes away your score. So when you don't have anything else you want to do, you pass your turn. If your opponent passes, once both players pass, the game is over, you add up the territory, count the prisoners and dead stones, then you tally the scores. So let's consider like this situation. It's white's turn. The board is pretty much played out, but is there anything white should do, or should white pass? Is there any more territory he could win, any more stones he could capture, anything like that? At first it's tempting, he should play at e4 and capture that stone. But that's unnecessary, because this is very definitively white's territory, because these are both eyes. Because there's no way that black can capture them. If black can't play here because it would run out of liberties and it's not capturing any stones. This is definitely white's territory, so that black stone is dead. If you play there to capture it, all it does is take away one point of your territory unnecessarily. So that's not going to matter. You don't want to play anywhere in here because that would just be a death trap. It's all black's territory and they would capture you very quickly. Down here, it looks like we see 2 points of dame because it's bordering both the colors. And it will be 2 points of dame if it's black's turn first, because black will fill in there, white will fill in there. And then it will be 1, 2, 3, 4, 2, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Black will win, 4-5. However, if white plays first, he can push black out a little bit by playing here. Now, instead of 2 points of dame, white gains 1 point of territory in the lower right-hand corner, because now that is definitely surrounded by white stones. So if white plays there instead of passing, he will gain 1 point of territory. And when then it becomes black's turn, there's nothing for him to do. He'll pass, white passes, and then it'll end up being 5-5. Let's go through some more in-game stuff. So this scenario, it's white's turn. Is there anywhere that white should move, anything he can do to improve his situation, or should he pass? Opinions? What was that? I thought I heard something. Possibly, maybe? A3 or E3? Left or right? I know you're thinking through this as you're saying it. Well, let's examine those. A3, really don't need to do that. That would make two eyes, but that's unnecessary because black can't stop you from making two eyes, so you don't need to waste your own territory doing that. E3, well, I don't see any way you're going to be able to capture black stuff because now all black has to do is play here. And white can try to play somewhere else, but then black just makes two eyes and those become dead stones. So in this scenario, there is nothing white can do. White should pass here because there's nothing left to accomplish. And furthermore, if white plays in d3, then he just gets captured. And it really doesn't affect the square because now black filled in one more point of his territory, but he captured the prisoner, stays the same. I wanted to throw in at least one where you do actually want to pass because you will have those situations in your game where at some point you do have to pass. You can't just keep trying to do things. Eventually you do run out of stuff to do. So another endgame situation. It's white's turn. Is there anything he can do to accomplish more things? Surrounding more territory, capturing stones, or protecting his own stones? Opinions, ideas? I like making you think. It goes very much a thinking game and gives me a chance to drink. Any suggestions? Well, it would be nice to help out the white stone on the top, but there's nothing we can do. No matter white plays, black could play in either C or D and make two eyes. All you'd be doing is giving him an extra prisoner. And we see white has a bunch of territory here, but this territory is actually weak because it's possible for black to play here. Now this white stone is in the tari, and if white tries to expand his liberties by going here, he still only has one liberty, then black can capture it. So this white stone was weak. So that means if it's white's turn, then we should play here and strengthen that. It does cut into our territory one, but it's worth it to protect that white stone and prevent black from invading down, around, and along the side. Black cannot get a similar thing going over here because of the stone at one. Similarly, white could have played the stone down here. No matter where black tries to invade, he can't play in A1 because it's illegal. He can try to play in B2, but white will immediately capture him. So there's no point in doing that. But white was much weaker over on the other side because he didn't have that stone already here. That's what allowed black to make that invasion, if white doesn't strengthen it first. Does this make sense? Any questions? Okay. I believe I have, was this 3 or 4? I think that was 4. Nope, that was 3. Okay, another endgame scenario. It is white's turn. Is there anything white should do to capture, expand territory, strengthen his stones because he has to, or should he pass? In this situation, at first glance, it might appear B5 is a point of dominance because it has lots of colors around it, but these three black stones only have one liberty. So if white plays there, they're captured. And that actually tips the scales and the difference between white winning or losing. If it's black's turn at that point, of course, he just plays in B5 and links all of his stones together. And these stones all the way down here are safe because they touch all of these stones all the way around through to these two eyes. So that whole group is now invincible. So it really is about who gets to play next in most of these scenarios. One more situation to talk about of rules called Comey. You might be able to deduce that it's possible to get essentially an infinite loop in Go. With this situation in the upper left-hand corner, it's possible for white to capture the black stone. Okay, but now that white stone is entire, it's possible for black to capture the white stone, and back and forth, and back and forth, and back and forth forever. Of course, that doesn't actually happen. There's a rule to stop that called Comey. If your opponent captures one of your stones, you're not allowed to capture that stone on your next turn. It essentially stops you from undoing your opponent's previous turn. So right now, after white played here, black is not allowed to capture that stone this turn. He can play somewhere else, then white plays somewhere else, then he can capture that stone if he wants. That is, unless white uses his next move to fill in the liberty here, which often happens. And the reason you want to do that is because that will link all these stones together. You'll have a nice little plus shape of 5 stones, and each one of these black stones is separated from each other, and each of these have 2 liberties. It's a very strong shape next to a very weak shape. So it's very good to get that winning blow in the co-fight. This is back and forth, it's called co-fighting. The rule is co that stops you from doing that. So in this situation, white played there, took the black stone, and black is not allowed to immediately retake it. So black has to do something else. So black will play down here. The goal when you're doing this co stuff is you want to make a move that forces your opponent to respond to it. You want to do something that's more important for them to play at as opposed to filling in that last co point. So in this situation, black is threatening to slice these 2 stones apart. If black gets to play here, then he will have two linked stones with two white stones on each side. So those white stones will be separated by the black stones, which is very good for black. If white gets to play next, he might play white right here, and so he'd have two linked stones, and you'd be able to be much stronger against that black stone. So now white has a choice. He can either fill in and win the ko, or he can address the situation in the lower right-hand corner. He's probably going to address the lower right-hand corner. Now it's black's turn. Two moves have passed since the initial ko, or since the initial capture, so black is not violating the rule of ko by capturing that. Now let's say it's white's turn. He is not allowed to immediately retake that because of ko. He has to go somewhere else, try to force his opponent to respond. Well, white can play here and threaten that black stone atari, but this is actually a special kind of atari called a ladder, where in this situation, it's impossible for black to escape capture. Black can try to run if he wants to, but white can keep pushing him around till eventually black will hit the edge of the board and he runs out of liberties. This can be as far as you want, all the way across the board. It'll keep that zigzag pattern all the way down until eventually you will run out of space and you will be captured. So black can see this. When white makes that move, he can see that's going to be a ladder. That stone is doomed. I'm not going to give him any more prisoners, so I'm not going to bother to respond there. In that situation, black can then fill in the ko. Any questions with that rule, its repercussions, or how it works? Okay, that's pretty much it for the rules of Go. If you're like how I was in this situation, knowing the rules didn't leave me feeling like I knew how to play. This little question is a question of what is a good move? It's not really addressing the rules. You know, how do you play well? So I have an example game I want to go through. Actually, first, there's one other idea I want to talk about. I forgot. Yes, outer inner. So one thing I touched on before is that it's easier to defend the corners and the sides than it is the center. In this situation, each of these three black groups are surrounding 9 points of territory. But in the upper left, it's only taking 7 stones. On the right, it's taking, 11, I believe. So that's 5 plus 3 plus 3, 11 stones. And here, it takes the same plus another 5, so it takes 16 stones. So it takes much fewer stones to defend the corners and the sides because you can depend on the edge of the board to add one more border to your stones. Furthermore, if you look at these star points, if you drew a line around all the star points, so a square box around there, if you added up all the territory on the outside and all the territory on the inside, it'd be the same. So it's much easier to defend the spaces around the edge of the board, and there's a lot of space there because it's equal to the inside of the board. So you'll see people fighting for the outside of the board before they start working on the inside. When you're playing chess, the center of the board tends to be the most important because all the pieces can move towards there. That's where all the battle happens. In Go, it's almost the opposite because it's so hard to defend the center. It's not worth it until you have a lot of battling done on the sides already, in the corners especially. The star points are often special in that people will often place their first couple moves on and around the star points because it's a very good balance. If you place a move like starting on S18 near the corner, it's establishing that you're going to eventually surround this piece of territory. But it's such a small amount of territory that your opponent will be able to get much more than you do. And if you start playing like maybe right here, there'll be so much space between you and the corner, then your opponent will be likely to invade. So you have to strike that balance between getting territory and not letting your opponent get it. And the star points just happen to be a very good balance between those, and that's why they're marked off specially. Like I said, the rules don't say the star points are special. It just happened to be because of how the game works. So we'll start with the game itself. This is played on a 13 by 13 board. You can use technically any odd number of size. You want an odd number, so there is a definitive central point. The most common sizes are 9 by 9, 13 by 13, and 19 by 19. You know, professional and very advanced amateur players will only use the 19 by 19 boards, but when you're starting out, the 9 by 9 and 13 by 13 are very good because they go a lot faster. You can see and learn from your mistakes in a much shorter time span. Especially on the larger boards, the full repercussions of a move might not be felt until much later. So I would highly recommend starting with 13 by 13 or 9 by 9 even. So this is a 9 by 9 board, and we'll start seeing what these people do. They start out playing the star points, or close to them. You can play closer to the sides to get a little more safe, or you can play further away from them to establish a little more territory. It's just a matter of preference. Once the star points are taken, then you start kind of filling in your territory, making imaginary walls of, I want to establish this area of territory. Here, by that move, black is saying, I want to have all of this stuff. in some ways goes almost like a negotiation where you're trying to negotiate with your opponent saying, you get this territory, I get this territory. Of course, there's some fighting involved because you're going to disagree about how much you get because you each want more than your opponent. Another general thing to keep in mind when playing Go is that you don't need to get all of the territory. You don't need to capture your opponent's stones. You only need one more point than they get. It's very common when you start playing to want to, if you see an opponent's stone, capture it. You don't want to do that. You do not have to capture all their stones. All you have to do is mark off more territory than they do. If you're overly aggressive and try to capture all of their stones, they will slice and dice you to pieces. I mean, you can more than welcome to try it and see how it works. And that's, there's a common Go saying about strategy. Before thinking about strategy, a beginner should first play and lose their first 100 games. Then you start thinking about strategy. And at first I balked when I heard that, but now I've played it a bit, I've found that there are a lot of basic mechanics to the game, the interactions between the stones, that is very hard to explain, but you will pick up on very quickly when you start playing. So you don't want to start reading books on deep strategy before you get a good number of games under your belt. You'll learn a lot. You'll learn so much more from your first 10 games than you will by reading any Go book at this point. So you definitely want to get some games under your belt before you start thinking about lots of strategy. So we start playing Go in strategy. White wants to strengthen his place on the left. Black, he's playing close to his stone, but far enough that is getting strategy. That is getting more territory. You could just make a solid link of stones as you're playing all the way around, but that would be very, very slow. It would take a long time to make a large amount of territory, and it's just way too slow. Your opponent will make large amounts of territory before you do that, but if you place stones haphazardly all over the board saying, I want the whole board, then your opponent's going to capture you very easily. So you strike this balance where you place your stones close to your own stones, but not so close that they're touching, because you want to be able to establish as much territory as possible as quickly as you can. So black plays a little bit away from his own stone. White plays very far away from his own stone. This is much closer to the black stone. It's a much more aggressive move, saying, I want to get as much of this territory as possible. Of course, black is not going to like that, so he responds by placing close to white's stone. And this is still close to his own stone, so it's still relatively safe. Now we start getting our first fight of the game. White starts trying to surround that black stone, and they interact with each other, making a little bit of a line. Now white has put this black stone in Atari. If white goes there, he would capture that stone. Black isn't going to allow that, so he links all the stones up. Now he has these four stones linked together. They all share liberties. And now we have three white stones. They're all unlinked, and this stone only has two liberties. This has three, and this has three. So he was probably going to start linking some of these up in order to give them more liberties to prevent them from being captured. So white will go up there, link those stones. Now black puts that stone in Atari. White puts that stone in Atari. So now each of those stones are in Atari, and black will capture the white stone. He now has one prisoner. White will start to try, he's going to want to try to wall off this section so he can keep this territory down here for himself. Black doesn't want to allow that to happen, so he puts that stone in Atari. But white captures, and it starts a Co situation here, where black is not allowed to capture the stone immediately back because that would undo the previous move. Black has to move somewhere else, and this, actually by happenstance, is the same situation I talked about before, where black plays up here, threatening to cut these two stones in half, which very much weaken white's position in the upper left-hand corner, because black would have those two stones linked together, white stones would be separated. White doesn't want to let that happen, so he instead will play to strengthen those stones. So now these two stones are linked together, and it's much stronger against that one black stone. Now black, since he's moved somewhere else, is able to respond to the Co and capture white stones back. Now white is not able to move to capture that stone. He has to go somewhere else. He plays up here, an invasion of black's territory. It's up to black whether he wants to decide that it's more important to respond to white in the upper right-hand corner or to capture the black stone in the lower right, or capture the, or fill in here to prevent white from capturing that stone. Black decides to respond in the upper right, which frees up white to respond with a Co again. Now it's black's turn. I'm sorry, now it's white's turn because, no, white played there, captured the black stone. Now it's black's turn. He plays in the upper left, which continues the fight up there, but it's not as unbalanced of a fight as it was when black first moved up there. They each have some stones there, so it's not as important for white to respond there. So that gives white an opportunity to fill in the space from that Co. Now he has a stronger group down there. Black will continue the fight up there, putting that stone in Atari, and white will link them up to prevent that stone from being captured. They now shell their liberties. Black strengthens his group up there. White adds to his invasion in the upper right-hand corner. He wants to try to make a space large enough that he can make two eyes, because that will make him alive, and Black will be unable to capture him. Black wants to stop this from happening, so he wants to squeeze down White's territory as small as he can and surround the stones. And again, you don't have to actually surround all the stones and take away all their liberties to kill them. You just have to make it impossible for them to get two eyes, and the stones will become dead in your territory. So they're right now they're going around defining a border, pushing against each other, trying to get, they each have their own goals. White wants to make as much territory as possible, pushing downward. Black wants to stop that territory from being made. At the same time, making sure not to leave stones out that can get captured easily. Like in this situation, White was worried about that stone being captured, so he links them all together. And Black continues pushing against White for the territory. And so in this situation, actually, not just yet, but Black will link up that stone because that was an Atari, and White will link his, wrong direction, White will link his stone. Now in this situation, that white group in the upper right is alive. It has no eyes right now, so according to the very wording of the rules, it doesn't have two eyes, it's not alive, but it will be impossible for Black to stop him from making two eyes. No matter what Black does, White will be able to make two eyes, so that group is now alive. We can play through some scenarios and see how that would work out. Let's say Black decides to play here, which is often a very common thing. If you're trying to make eyes, it's often a center point that will split the shape up into multiple eyes that will give you your life. Now White can play here, and now for these two points, no matter which one Black plays in, White will play in the other and it'll create two eyes, one for here and one here. So that's not gonna work for Black. If instead Black played, you know, here where they'd made one eye, then White can play here. And now, regardless of which one of these two places Black moves, White plays in the other, and it makes two eyes, one here and one here. It is impossible for Black to stop White from making two eyes there, therefore the group is now alive without doing any of these moves I just showed. That is a theoretical thing, and both of the players acknowledge that. And so Black decides to take the fight somewhere else and starts an invasion on the left-hand side of the board. He wants to stop White from simply walling off the territory here and getting this whole swath of territory for himself. And White, of course, wants to do that, so he responds in the area. Black starts to build up a little bit of a wall, and White starts a wall on the other side. And now White has determined that he wants to try to get that corner territory for himself, so he tries to build a wall going up to the top. This stone is going to be captured soon if Black doesn't do anything, so he links up the stones so they all share the same liberties. White starts an invasion on the right-hand side. And again, White wants, now Black has pretty much separated the left stones from the right stones, so this White group is on his own. He needs to make enough space in here that he can make the two eyes like he had up here. But this is going to end up a little different for White. So White tries to make as much as possible. Black tries to fence him in. But here, Black was able to move in the territory a lot farther than he was up here. This is because instead of just bordering against the corner, he's bordering against his own stones up here. So he can make a move that aggressive into White's territory because he can draw on the power of these stones if he needs to by linking into them if that stone gets threatened. So he's able to push a lot farther into this territory than he was able to up here. So in this situation, White has a much smaller area to work with, but he does what he can. And so in this situation, for that group there, it's not alive right now. If White is able to move in M6, then White would be alive because that would be filled in and there'd be two eyes here. It's not actually two eyes yet because these are not linked, but it'd be impossible for Black to stop those from linking. I'm gonna leave that as magical hand waving for now. So if White were able to move here, he would be able to link up those stones. Unfortunately, it is not White's turn, it's Black's turn. He wants to kill, so Black goes there. At first, at just quick glance, it seems like a suicidal move. He's going there, he's surrounded by white stones. That stone may very well be doomed, but it stops the white stones from making two eyes, therefore it stops the group from being alive, therefore they will all be dead prisoners. So that works out very well for Black. White laments his loss and moves on, instead of fighting here, which is eventually going to be a losing fight anyway. So here he puts the black stone in Atari, Black puts a white stone on Atari, white captures. So now he has a nice little space down there. Black makes a nice little group of stones that can easily link up to each other if they want to, which gets a bit of territory in the lower right for black. And white decides to start working on the left-hand side again. We can already see here the game is taking shape a bit, where white's going to have territory up here, black's going to have territory around here, probably going to be white around here, maybe black. The battle lines are starting to be drawn. The game's taking shape. Go is kind of like an interactive drawing where both of you are trying to draw as large of colors as you can. So black wants to be able to seal this off and probably capture these two stones as dead stones. That's what he'd like to do the most. Of course, white's going to not try to let that happen. This white stone's an Atari. He doesn't want to let that go, so white will link that stone. Black solidifies his position a little more. White's probably going to, instead of letting black cut through here, he's going to wall it off and keep this territory for himself. That's what I'll try to do. Black links up his territory. Each of them solidify a bit. When you get to this point in the game, it's mostly about solidifying your own territory and preventing your stuff from being captured. And so in this situation, white is trying to link this group up to these stones. If white gets to play in here, then he'll manage to get two eyes, one eye here and one eye down here. Then all the stones will be alive, because through that long link of all the stones going there, that group, all of its spans, will be touching two eyes. But of course, black sees that easily, and he cuts the group. So now, this group is still off by its lonesome. It's still dead, unfortunately, for white. Now they push up against each other. When it's getting to this point, it's starting to just, it's worrying about the very edges of the territory. And this up here is a great example. You can tell that both of those columns, the white and the black, are just going to extend up from there to the edge of the board. But how exactly they extend up has a very large effect on the score. So if it's white's turn, white could play at c13, then black plays at d13. They're just going straight up, they're boarding against each other, it works. But because it's black's turn, he can just push a little bit into white's territory with that c13 stone. Now, white is not able to capture that. If he plays at d13 to try to surround it, then white will just capture it because it'll have, black will capture the white stone because it will only have one liberty. But white is only able to wall off the territory as best as he can, and they each solidify here. Now, because black was able to go first, white had to bump out his wall a little bit. White lost 2 points of territory because black made that move first. So this is what happens a lot at the end game, is just little bits of pushing and shoving as you get the final points of the territory surrounded, and you try to maximize each bit of territory that you can. I'll speed up a little bit through some things. Again, black invaded a little bit in that territory, just pushed in, white had to wall it off where it can. They're solidifying their walls, essentially just finishing what was already started here. Black could have played right next to white, which would have given white this territory. Instead, black pushes down a little bit and forces white to wall it off down here instead. And essentially just finishing the walls, speed through the last little bit of it. And once they got, once they got to here, at that point, there's no more territory to be gotten. Now, this is white's territory, this is white's territory, this is black's territory with the dead stones in it. There's only the dame points, like the stuffing here, this point. And this is where black and white start filling in the dame just by taking turns placing the stones. Doesn't matter who places where. And so now the game is over. They've each done all they want to do. Each player passes. So we can remove the prisoners, in which case we'll mark those manually with the group. So there's this group that's all dead stones. And there was, there's something else. This black stone. It's in a wide bit of white territory. It doesn't have a chance to live. That's a dead stone. And if we let the game add up the territory for us, see the score. The Japanese count, black 38 to white 37. But there's one more rule I want to cover very quickly before I finish the talking. As you might guess, black has a bit of advantage by going first because it can mark the territory first. So there's a rule called Komi where white gets a 5.5 point lead, or 5.5 points added to its score at the end of the game. So black has to actually win by 6 points in order to really win the game. And it's also possible to give a handicap to black. If you say you give a one stone handicap, you play as normal, but you don't give black, if you don't give white the Komi, you don't get the 5.5 points. Playing on a full 19 board, if you want to give two stones, then black starts with two stones on the board. That's called a two stone handicap. This can go all the way up to 9 stone handicap, where black starts with 9 stones on the board, filling in all the various points. That's a big advantage for black, and it's something you use if the black player is much weaker than the white player. That's the whirlwind tour of Go. Any questions? Okay, I'm going to be up in the game room for the most of the rest of the weekend, so if you want to play Nego or ask questions about it or try out a game, just feel free to ask. KGS.net is an online Go server. It's a very good way to get started. There's a lot of resources. You can Google around. There's a Go book up in the game room if you want to read that. That's where I took that example game from because it was a good example of balance between white and black. And there's lots of other resources. So, thanks.